If you want even more details about this topic, check out the link below in the description to go to the lesson page on programmingelectronics.com. You'll find supporting material like the written lesson, a quiz to test if you understand the topic, supporting code, and more. Hello, I hope you're doing fantastic. So right now, we are in the middle of a series exploring the Arduino millis function and the Arduino delay function. Because what we ultimately want to do with this video series is figure out how to create repetitive timed events with Arduino. Say, for example, every couple minutes we want a servo motor to move, or say we want to update a web server every 20 seconds. How do we create these repetitive timed events? Do we use delay? Do we use millis? Well, if you've been following along in the series, the answer is it really depends. Now, we're going to continue where we were building from the last lesson in this video. In the last lesson, we looked at one example where using the delay function would become an issue with repetitive timed events. And that was when we had two timed events that overlapped with each other. In this lesson, we're going to look at an issue that arises when we want to have a repetitive timed event, but also have an input into our system. Now, if you haven't seen the previous videos, I highly recommend, after this is over, going back, watching them, and then continuing on. All right, so let's go ahead and get started. So we're going to pick up where we left off in the last lesson. So if you recall, we were working on a project. Remember, we were throwing a party, and we had a giant cardboard cutout of you at the front door to welcome people. And what we wanted to do is we had the eyes as LEDs, and the LEDs were blinking back and forth, and that was cool. And then we added a servo to the arm so that it would wave. But we realized, you know, we were having trouble getting the timing of those events to overlap. So now what we've decided, you know, we thought, okay, this waving arm thing is really sweet, but let's just get rid of the servo. And instead, let's add a third eye. You know, that would be cool. And we'll have a button on your chest that we press. If somebody presses it, the third eye lights up on the forehead. And it like hypnotizes them or something, or you know, it has that effect. That would be kind of cool. So what we're gonna do is we're gonna jump back into the code and we'll do this thing where we've got the button. Again, this is the same sketch from the last lesson. So again, I highly recommend you check that out if you haven't yet. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna go through here and I'm gonna get rid of the servo code. So I'll do that now. So what that leaves us with is two LEDs, one at pin 7 and one at pin 8. We set their modes as outputs in the setup. And then in the loop, we use a for loop for 10 times to go through and alternate which LED is on. So first we turn the left LED high and then the right high, or the left eye rather, the left eye high and then the right eye high. So those two LEDs, one's on, one's off. We delay for 100 milliseconds and then we turn the other one low and the other one high. All right, so it's this cool kind of effect and it iterates 10 times. So now what we want to do is add an additional LED, a third LED, which will be the third eye for our prop. And then we want to add a button circuit. And every time we press the button, we want that LED to come on. So the first thing I'll do is designate some pins for the additional LED and the button. So let me do that now. So I've added two more constants, LED third eye. I've set it equal to pin 6. That's where we have that other LED attached to, and then the button pin, and I've got a simple button circuit attached to pin 5. Now in void setup, I'm going to go ahead and set that LED pin as an output. And now what I'm going to do down in the loop, after this for loop, after the, you know, the flickering LED eye effect, I'm going to go ahead and add an if statement. And what I want this if statement to do is, if the button is being pressed, what I want to do is turn the LED on. Otherwise, I want the LED to be off. So I'm going to go ahead and code that right now. So we upload the code, step back. You know, it's cool. The LED eyes are flickering back and forth. We really like that effect. It's working great. We walk up and we press that button and something doesn't seem quite right. Sometimes when we press the button, the LED lights up kind of quick, but other times we have to wait. There's quite a substantial delay before the LED actually turns on. And then we find when we let go of the button, sometimes instead of the LED turning off immediately, the LED lags a little bit. It like stays on for a while. So what's going on here? What's the issue? All we want to do is get an input into our code to have a LED light up, but it doesn't seem to be working. What's going on? So if we look at the code that we've written, we've got our big loop, right? Our void loop. And my question is this loop a tight loop or not? And I would say that this is not a tight loop. And the reason I say that is because we have a for loop right here. This is the piece of code that we first jump into. And I have to ask ourselves, how long does it take to get through this loop? Well, how many delays do we have in here? We've got two delays, each 100 milliseconds each. So that's 200 milliseconds. And we're going to iterate through this loop 10 times. So that's 10 times 200, which is 2,000 milliseconds, which would be 2 seconds. I think I'm doing the math right there. So for 2 seconds, we're not doing anything else except this little lighting routine that we came up. So what happens when I'm pressing the button during that 2 seconds? Well, nothing's happening. And that's because we're not getting down to this digital read frequently enough to see if that button has actually been pressed. So if I hold the button and I keep it pressed, then when this for loop ends, then this if statement will see, oh yeah, look, hey, the button's being pressed. Let me go ahead and write that LED high so that the third eye comes on. And then it goes out, it exits that, and then it comes back up to this for loop, and it starts executing this for loop again for 2 seconds. And now if I let go of the button in this period right here, the LED was still written high. So the LED is not going to be written low again until after this entire for loop finishes. And we get down to the if statement again, we see that the button is not high, so the button hasn't been pressed, and we get to that else statement and turn the LED off. So this for loop is blocking the input that we want to read. So if we have a program where we want a repetitive timed event, but we also want to have an input into our system, then we may find that using the delay function isn't going to be the best fit, and we should seek an alternative method to program it, perhaps using the millis function. We might also consider using an interrupt to execute some routine while another for loop is going on like this. But for the purpose of this series, we're going to be exploring why the millis function can be a great option. So let me go ahead and recap the last two lessons so we can get really clear on when it makes sense to use a delay function and when it might be better to seek an alternative solution, perhaps using the millis function. Okay, so if you have one or more repetitive timed events and they don't overlap in time, that is one happens and then another, then using the delay function is a great solution. The delay function allows us to keep the program flow really simple, and it's just an easy function to use. Now, there's two circumstances where using the delay function can get a little tricky. The first, which we talked about in the last lesson, is when we have two timed events that overlap. When that happens, we run into issues with delay. The other time that we've talked about in this lesson is if we are trying to read an input and use that input in our system. As we've demonstrated here, any blocking code, including the delay function, can make it difficult to read an input frequently enough to update the input for your program. So if you have a repetitive timed event and you also need to be monitoring inputs, then you might want to consider dumping the delay function for something else, for example, the millis function. All right, so what we're going to do in the next lesson is start to look at how we can use the millis function to overcome the two issues we just identified in these last two lessons. All right, I look forward to seeing you there. Bye.